welcome to the Ski Racing Podcast Extra with me, Ed Drake. Tord Nilson and I are back to have a look at the final set of races before Christmas. It was the turn of the men's tech tour to get those race bibs back on. First up is the GS and slalom from Alta Badia before we take a look at the night slalom from Madonna di Campiglio. It was great, Tord, to some more racing.
Yeah. And I feel like we've had so much racing this weekend.
Feels like speed races were like a week ago.
Yeah, I know, I've aged a lot.
Exactly.
It was awesome. It was great to get the tech stuff going. Do you know what? Alta Badia is a really interesting course. Because I feel like when you look on TV, it doesn't quite do it justice, right? And I've skied there. And it is a lot steeper than it looks.
Yeah, I don't think the TV really does it justice. It's very narrow. It's very steep. I mean, from the set, obviously, they always set something that swings across the hill a lot in GS, but they do that because it's so steep. I just don't think they've got the camera angles right to show how tricky that course is. Mm. And I think it's something to do with how narrow it is. I can't think otherwise why not, because a lot of the races you can see and the angles are really good at sort of honing in and showing you, you know, how tough the race hill is. But Alta Badia, the piece looks easier than it actually is.
Absolutely. And I think the weather didn't help either. It was minging. It was an awful... it was a day when you just wouldn't... As a recreational skier, you'd go and have a hot chocolate.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you?
Or a beer, I think.
Or a beer.
I think what is annoying is that we've... Like, those race hills, Alta Badia and Madonna, those places are... You know, those are races where you really look forward to watching and it really does showcase the best of World Cup skiing. And the snow condition, it's so frustrating when the snow conditions play such a big part. And I know that it's an outdoor sport.
Yeah.
And I know
we've
that
been
the
through
best
this,
skiers
already,
will win and they've got to adapt to the conditions.
Yeah.
But it's just frustrating when it's not a fair crack of the whip. Just when it plays such a big part in the result.
Yeah.
And I think that's the frustration.
I totally agree. But, you know, it's just
racing,
part and parcel of ski racing at the end of the day. And that's why we can sit and analyse and moan.
Who doesn't have a good moan at this time of the year with all that's going on at the moment?
Anyway, let's move on to the podium. Third, Justin Marussia from Switzerland. Switzerland back on the podium.
Yes.
How was his run? What did he do right?
Well, he moved up from 11th to 3rd on that second run. He's been knocking on the door for a while. He had to take time off earlier in the winter due to COVID. He sat out. I spoke to him through the podcast media channels, and I spoke to him, and he said that he was ill. He definitely felt bad and sick when he had COVID. So to come back from that and pick up a podium is wicked. He skied really smooth. He dealt with the conditions really nicely. And I think what you do see from the people that did well, especially in the GS, they're the ones that adapt really well. They're the ones that have the really good touch on the ski and able to feel what's going underneath them and make those adaptations rather than just going, this is how I ski.
Yeah.
And I'm going to do it no matter what the conditions are.
Absolutely, and that is a key element of staying consistent, staying on, and getting on the podium.
Absolutely.
Second, we've got Alton McGrath, not American.
No.
American dad, Norwegian nationality.
Yeah.
He skied really well. He was only 0.07 behind the eventual winner.
Yeah.
Crackers, yeah. I'm a big fan of this skier as well.
Oh, you know what? The Norwegians are coming at the World Cup with some force this season. Yeah, he went from fourth to second. He was bib 29 and he went into fourth on the first run and put down an absolute storm. I was really hoping for your fairy tale.
Yeah.
And I hoped that he was going to take the win from Pinturault, but he didn't quite have enough on that second run to overhaul Pinturault as well. But he skied really beautifully.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, him, you've got Bratton as well, the two young guns, you know, those two guys really pushing each other. And as a team, what a training buddy those two have got in each other. And I expect to see, you know, those two are going to be a real force. Are they the new Svindal and Jansrud?
Well, that's really interesting you said that, because I think that generation thing can be a real issue. When you're getting to the end of their careers, like Jansrud, and then you're kind of like, well, you need to feed the next line of kind of successors. Well, and I mean, this is definitely the
you look at the success of Svindal and Jansrud, and half of that success, well, not half, but a lot of that success is down to the fact that those two pushed each other throughout pretty much their whole career. And we've talked about it at length here, and we've talked about it at length on the podcast, that actually Janser took time to find his feet post Svindal.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so those two as a training partnership, you know, your Aumont and Kuss, you've got obviously Jansrud and Svindal, and then these little pairings have a big say on how well you do, I think.
I think Norway have really smashed that in terms of the growth of their ski team. We get to the winner, Pinturault. I mean, he's a great, great skier. He has a sparkly helmet. it must just be experience, surely, in these times to take that win in such difficult conditions.
You don't ever expect anything else other than consistency from Alexei. He is so experienced, and he's never somebody that you look at and hold your breath. Is he going to make a stupid mistake? You know, like so many of the racers, you sort of are waiting to see if they make the mistake. And Pinturault never actually really makes a big mistake. He picks it up so quickly, he adapts, he changes. And he was just so good. Mm. Like technically, and we'll look at it in a second, but technically so good. No foot is put wrong ever with his skiing, and he adapts to bumps and undulations with ease.
Yeah, and he seems to just be able to adapt to all disciplines as well. Potentially someone to look for the overall there.
Oh, absolutely. 100%. He's got a good hold on that overall already. The thing is, Kilder, who picked up big points in the speed races earlier on over the weekend, but Kilder is going to have to start picking up big points in GS, because we've seen how well we see Pinturault doing now, and Pinturault's not bad at the old Super G either. So
he's not bad at anything.
No, he's not too
bad. That's awesome. Right, Ed, let's have a look how he did it.
And here is Alexei Pinturault's winning run. 0.46 he had at the start. Atlee McGrath leading in the finish area. Last man on the hill. All the pressure on this man's shoulders, but does he buckle? Absolutely no chance. He is one of the most technically gifted athletes on the tour, and of all time, to be fair. His technique is something else. But watch this. Watch this outside ski just here. Comes across. He's got to have a bit of a stivet in there. It's quite steep. It's quite narrow. But just take a look at this outside ski as we roll on. Bounces around and then finds grip. Like he wouldn't even notice that he's just had a fairly decent wobble on his outside ski, on his turning ski. But he just moves so cleanly from turn to turn, just comes out here. He's setting up nice and high. He's got the upper body facing to the direction that he's traveling in. We get so used to people talking about direction of travel being down the hill, but that means that you end up being counter-rotated. So what he is doing is he's following a direction of travel, means that his hip is able to stay square to the direction that he's going. And what it does is means that he's able to roll up at the start of the turn, and just watch how smooth he gets his hip up. Yes, he's chucked them sideways a little bit, but that's just the nature of how tough and offset this piece is. So clean. Then that separation comes in, driving over the outside ski, and those heads are biting throughout the turns. Coming across into that middle flat, he's kept his advantage pretty much. This is one of the turns that comes out, comes up nice and early, gets good pressure, good separation, nice and tight on the gates. He's looking to try and ride his way through the ruts. What you can't do as the 30th man on the second run, or the first run to be fair, is to go straight and drop into the ruts. You have to get the rut nice and early. Otherwise, if you drop into it, then you hit it and it'll bounce. And that's when you see a load of pre-releases. So really important to make sure that you find that rut nice and early. He comes up at high, early, gets the turn done above the gate, and then comes round through. Just watch, keep an eye on his hips through here. A good move to get up and over onto the front of the ski. Small drift, and then back onto it over his outside foot. Again, hip up and through. Watch that he moves over onto the tips, keeps the pressure on the tips of the outside ski. He's lost a little bit of time, but Atlee McGrath has gone down a couple earlier and just managed to link those turns a little bit nicer on that middle section. But now Pinturault coming up and through again, gets good separation through these turns. Loads of pressure on his outside ski. Make sure that direction of travel is done before he gets to the gate. So this is a release. This phase is then all about building at the start of the next as early as he possibly can. Carries the speed off of this steep, gets pushed into the back seat, but all that core strength just means it's just part and parcel of the game. Doesn't chuck him really sideways, gets pushed into the soft snow, doesn't panic, and gets back over the outside ski. Next section of turns, the nice steep bit coming towards the finish, and he's found a couple of hundredths of a second, but he's just so smooth, so controlled. Lovely roll up onto the turn. He's got his chest again facing down. It's a slight counter, and he's still facing out this way. He's not facing down the hill, which is this way. Just allows him to build that pressure nice and early. Here he goes. Drives that outside ski. And this is all about trying to gun it as straight as possible, working really hard to get that acceleration from turn to turn. And Pinturault picks up the elusive win on Alta Badia's giant slalom.
All right, so we stay in Alta Badia for the slalom. Now, before we get going, I just want to remind everyone to subscribe and like this video because it helps us grow and we can then keep delivering kind of great analysis to you guys.
We're trying.
So please do like, share and subscribe. And also remember to check out the podcast on Apple.
It's not just on Apple. You can find it anywhere.
Sorry, you can find it anywhere.
Literally anywhere.
Anywhere, where you find the podcast. Let's move on to the slalom, still in Alta Badia. Still really tough conditions. It was wet, it was soft.
More conditions, which had a big effect on the outcome. We saw Dave Riding, Britain's favourite, finishing in 10th.
Absolutely.
I think he skied really well. From a British perspective, yep. I think it was a great start to season. First World Cup slalom of the year. Lots of athletes sort of finding their feet with a race bib on. Very different, obviously, in training to come perform in race day. And I think 10th was a really good platform to start from. He's in the second group, so between 8 and 15. Start number, which can be tricky, I think. It makes a big difference. They've started 15. I think in terms of all of the start numbers, it's 8 to 15, I think it's the biggest sort of difference in pace conditions. 1 to 7, it's all good, 1 to 7. 16 to 30, most, you know, it's bad already, and it gets a little bit worse and a little bit worse, and obviously got a bit worse than normal over the last couple of days because of the softness. But 8 to 15... 8 is, you know, is a big difference to 15.
Yeah.
And it might sound like I'm sort of talking around the houses, but actually I think that is quite a big draw. Yeah. And it's quite a lot of luck that goes into obviously where you start. And I think that's a big difference from starting 8th to starting 15th. So Dave started 15th. I thought he did really well.
Really well. Top 10 to get top 10. It's great. I thought he looked really good. He looked really aggressive, really smooth.
Comfortable on those.
Especially
on
the second run.
Yeah.
Which we've come to realise is really where he has a strength.
Second run charge.
Second run charge. Love it, Dave. The podium. Third place, we had Schwartz.
Yeah, Marco is back on the podium.
He is.
And Austria... as well as Fella, which we'll get onto. Austria
are breathing a sigh of relief.
That's exactly what I was going to say. They have been out baying for blood and from their races. And I think you actually saw quite a lot of that come out in the two guys on the podium.
Agreed.
I think they, you know, there's a bit of an outpouring of sort of relief, aggression. You know, the pressure is seriously on the Austrian ski team. And to deliver two guys on the podium, both with really good second runs, they took advantage of not the quickest first run, so they started earlier in the second run, just after a TV break, where the piece was given a good slide, and all praise them.
And I'm guessing Hirsch's dad will be happy because he is now the coach, isn't he? So he'll be happy that at least Austria are back on the podium. Or is he ever happy? That's the question.
Well, I don't know. I'm not sure you see him smile after that massive tash. I think you can see what's happening up behind there. But I think all in all, Austria will have woken up after Monday's race and after last night's race.
Let's move on to second place, which is Manny Feller. I'm a massive fan of him.
Me too.
He's a wild child, right?
Me too,
And you just go, you see him and you're like, he's going to either crash out in spectacular style or he might podium. It's millimetres, isn't it?
Yeah, but he has actually made an adjustment to his technique. He's known for being the wild child. He's known for being outrageous and sort of not knowing what's going to happen from turn to turn. And he managed to put two good runs down, which... throughout his whole career, has probably only happened a handful of times, to be fair. But he's made a slight adjustment. So normally, you know, he is very aggressive at the gate and he puts his big emphasis down onto the skis right by the gate. And I think in the last couple of seasons, that has ended up with a shoulders opening up and the shoulders going back and the hips being jetted forward. And he's worked really, really hard on staying further over the fronts. And if you have a look at him and keep your eyes out for when you're next watching the World Cup slalom, his shoulders are now way further forward. So when he does put all that pressure on at the gate, it's that pressure translates into an acceleration and his shoulders are ready for it. And it moves all together and it's less sort of wheelie, sort of esque for him.
Absolutely.
And I think they've worked really hard on it. He's worked really hard on it. And at one point, it looked like the Austrians had maybe neutered him a little bit in terms of calming down and looking for finishes. And obviously, that found him back in the 20s, start numbers. And I think, hopefully, he's now found the balance between the craziness.
Because we'd all love to see more of him.
He's one of the likable guys in the World Cup, isn't he? He's a good lad. He's one of those you'd quite happily go for a ski and a beer with.
Yeah, absolutely. Winning in Alta Badia was Zenhäuser.
The monster.
I mean, I keep saying it, but the Swiss are back.
Yeah.
I had him in the prediction league, so I was really happy to see him.
I was just thinking, that's all I lit this guy. Jesus. No, he deserved it, fully deserved it.
He did deserve it. He was on fire. What kind of, tell us about how he did it, really.
Inevitably, because he is 6'8", 220 or whatever that is, 220? Whatever, he's over 6'6", he's over 2 metres, he's 6'8", so he's a big dude. So all of the time when you hear people talking about him, they're always talking about how tall he is.
Yeah.
And always talking about how it's an advantage because he gets to have his legs a long way for his body, centre of mass can take a shorter racing line. But rightly on commentary, they talked about how, well, actually, it's not often you get somebody that's that tall that can move their feet that quickly. Mm-hmm. And he moved his feet really quickly. Yes, he's got long levers, so he can, the way that his centre of mass travels down is different. But Hirscher was, 5'6".
Yeah.
5'8", wherever he was. So he's not, and that's not a disadvantage.
No.
And he just uses what he's got to his strength. And he's got a lovely touch in his skis. He went from sixth to first.
Yeah.
He was really smooth. And he looked a little bit surprised when he came to the finish. And I picked him a lot last season when it came to the predictions league. And he's going to be up on my list to pick for the rest of them, I think.
Absolutely. Right, let's dive in and see how he did it.
Ramon Zenhuizen's second run has to do a bit of a charge. Moves up from 8th to 1st. You can just see how soft this snow is. Just have a look at the conditions are really, really tough. Not what you expect from a World Cup piece. The organisers did really well to make sure that we got some salt on there to make sure the conditions were as good as they possibly could have been. But just this man, have a look at the range of motion he gets. He's so tall, but he's still in control all of the time. The hip stays a little bit back just because he is so tall. He doesn't have the time. Slalom is too quick. The turns that come at you too quickly to do a full extension from low hip to a full hip. So he's just got to try and get the pressure onto the front of the skis as early as he can. Let's just see how accurate he is with these slalom skis. Comes through this hairpin, quick feet through there and starts diving down. We talked about it in the bit before we came online, just because he has got long levers, he just takes advantage of it. He's so far inside with his center of gravity, but he's still over the outside ski. Comes around, just seems unflappable at the moment. Contrary to GS, with slalom, you do keep your body weight face, your upper body facing further down the hill because you don't have the time and you don't have the offset either, where you need to be facing direction of travel. So watch with the slalom skiers, they keep everything nice and still, especially with that upper body. Ramon working hard to get his hip up and over through these turns. But every single time stuff goes on with his feet, hits bumps, hits a rut, he's able just to keep that contact. And the big fella is just cruising down across this flat, moves his feet super fast through the hairpins and verticales. And his feet just dancing the way down. The separation again from the big fella is awesome. Gives him great purchase even through these softer conditions. Nice and solid over the outside. And then dances his way down. just because of the, it's so rutted and bumpy, being in the centre of the ski is so important. Even when he gets out of shape, like the arms coming out to the side up here, just struggling to... he's using everything that he can do to try and absorb the ruts and the bumps. And I think he's managing to keep everything flowing in terms of what's happening under his feet, even through all the ruts and bumps. But so powerful. Keeps that drive all the way to the finish. No mistakes across the flat. And Ramon Zenhäusern picks up the first win of the 2020-2021 World Cup season in slalom.
Right, we move into the first night slalom of the season, which, slalom. I mean, we both love. Yeah. There's something about it, and I know there was no crowds, but it was just electrifying. People seemed to be really up for it. It was just awesome. And in the audience was my favourite skier of all time, Alberto Tomba, the legend himself.
Yeah, that is somebody that you want a little bit of time with to... Tell you some stories. That man's got some stories.
Absolutely.
The race was brilliant. Again, the snow was just not good enough. But I mean, they did as well as they could, and I think it was they did a good job on it. But it's just so frustrating that again, Madonna especially is the favourite for so many races.
Absolutely.
It's Dave Riding's favourite. It's Daniel Yule's favourite. Kristoffersen marks it as one of his favourites. There's so many guys that love racing there. And the snow conditions, again, playing a big part in the outcome.
Yeah.
I think, again, good. The best skier won on the day, obviously. But I just would love to, if we could have had it in the next couple of days when the temperatures really drop, and we're back to seeing, you know, rock hard.
A bit of bullet. Yeah.
Maybe go back.
Maybe
go Let's have another one.
So just before we dive into the podium, let's talk about night slalom. Let's talk about ski. You've skied it under floodlights.
I love it.
You love it.
Love it.
Explain a little bit for our viewers what you have to think about that's different to skiing during the daytime.
I'm not sure if there's anything necessarily different about it, but you see everything.
Mm.
You see absolutely everything. And sometimes that can play, you know, especially play a bit of a part in what's your decision-making, because you can see everything. So you see a little bit of a hole and therefore you really see the hole. And so maybe you make different decisions, but all in all, it's brilliant. I love racing under floodlights. There's something about, racing at night, just something a bit
it's
different.
It's like any other sport under floodlights, I guess. You play football under floodlights. Absolutely. And I think a lot of skiers, recreational or racers, they have skied, those certain days during the week where ski resorts have it under floodlights. It's always a bit special, isn't it? Night skiing.
Love it.
Absolutely.
Sign me up for any skiing, actually.
Especially this year. Let's move on to the podium. We had an Italian in third place, Alex Vinazza.
He is a really exciting talent for the Italians. He was leading the first run the previous day over in Alta Badia. He dropped back, having a couple of mistakes in the second run. He's a really old school skier, like quite upright in his body. Getting a little bit loose with his arms, but what's going on his feet is just natural. He's such a natural ski racer. And it's nice to see something different in terms of a different style. We'll talk about Foss Solovag in a minute. His skiing style is very different from the other guys on the podium. And I think it's really nice to see that there isn't one way to ski. But the thing I would say about Vinazza is that he takes risks, man. He diving bullet straight on so many gates, and if it's hard, it's going to be going seriously, seriously quick.
Yeah.
Youngster on the podium, 0.34 off. Italy have got another slalom gem there,
and with Tomba looking, what a great
performing for the big man.
Yeah, well, exactly. Yeah. That is what it is, and I think something like that with such a legend, being there and supporting him, I mean, that must be such a great boost.
Absolutely.
In that gate for run two. Second was Norway. I mean, Norway again.
Yeah.
I mean, as we just mentioned, they're flying. For Solvag, who had a great race. What can you say? He's consistent, he's good, he's exciting.
Yeah, I mean, he's in the top group. He's the sort of guy that you don't necessarily think about when it comes to picking a winner. He's somebody that's super consistent. He's always like fourth, sixth. He's always in that little bunch just after the podium.
Yeah.
And to see him leading after the first run, he had a big margin after that first run.
Absolutely.
Quite a shock to everybody as to where he got that speed from. I mean, it shouldn't be a shock because he's one of the world's best slalom skiers. But in terms of how he'd been able to make himself a quarter of a second, when you're talking super tight margins on really tricky snow.
Yeah.
But he fully deserves his second place. He's still searching for that World Cup win.
And that will come very soon. I reckon it'll come this season. I really do. I don't know if I'll predict him, but, you know, who knows? And then we come to the winner, Kristoffersen. It's great. I'll admit I'm not a massive fan of his. On the other hand, it was great to have him back winning. He said in the press conference afterwards that for him, he's got family and skiing. That is his life. And when one doesn't work out, it really gets him down. And I get that. And he gets an awful lot of criticism. He does, you know, we've spoken about it. He is a bit of a pantomime villain.
Yes.
Especially with Hirscher back in the day, a couple of seasons ago.
Yeah, a long time ago.
It feels like a long time ago. He really got it together and he won by a big margin. He was on a mission, right?
Yeah, he really was. 12th to first on that second run. And I totally agree. He was super emotional. He said it in his post-race that it was the most emotional victory of his entire career. And I think a bit of that is down to what you said, Todd, about how he's got skiing in his family and that's it. And so when it doesn't go right, when one of them's not functioning, you know, half of your life isn't functioning.
Yeah.
And I think he's taken a bit of stick because he's not necessarily been the Kristoffersen that we expected him to be after he or she retired. So, and I think he felt like he had to prove a load of doubters wrong. I thought, and actually, seeing that side of him, we are normally seeing him and talking about how he's throwing his stuff in the finish, he's shouting, screaming, effing and blinding.
Yeah.
But I felt really happy for him after that race. Mm. And again, I'm not somebody that's, you know, the hugest Kristoffersen fan. No. I think when his skiing is some of the best out there. But personally, for me, you know, the sort of whinging or, you know, getting annoyed at stuff after the race is not necessarily what I want to see. But yesterday, he was very emotional. And I think we saw that passion. We saw a bit more of a vulnerable side. I'm not saying that we need to see everybody's vulnerable side all of the time. But for somebody like him, I think I came away with a slightly different opinion of him.
Yeah.
And a better opinion of him. And he absolutely smashed that race. That second run, we're going to take a look at it in a second. That second run was awesome.
Yeah, and I think, you know, really keep an eye on the analysis, because this is where, if you're a budding young ski racer in slalom or any discipline, even a recreational, you can learn so much from Kristoffersen. He's a great skier. Let's check out how he did it.
And Henrik Kristoffersen, here is his winning run. After an emotional victory, this turned out to be, goes from 12th in to the lead, obviously, and then holds on till the end. But he was super aggressive, definitely had a point to prove on this second run. This Madonna slalom out of the start gate is pretty tricky straight from the get-go. But I want you to keep an eye on how accurate he is with his feet. From top to bottom, this man risks. He knows that the piece is bumpy and difficult in terms of what's happening under his feet, but he is able to still fight and take the risks that you need to try and win. He goes super direct. He looks to try and get the pressure early in the rut. And he was absolutely a man on a mission. Just this next section, he cuts in as early as he dare. The pressure comes on nice and smooth. The ski bites underneath him. Even through the rut, he's still able to stay in the center of his skis. Gets caught a little bit, but he just still takes the risk. This is him recovery after getting caught into this little rut just here. Chucks him a little bit lower than he anticipated and he risks everything. Look at that position. Not what you would see in a textbook, but exactly what you want to see from a racer. Chucking a couple of emergency moves and still keeping the skis arcing cleanly across the snow. Back into his comfortable position. Lovely separation again through here. He was absolutely fighting. And all you can see here, all of this spray coming off at the top of the turn is just him arcing it out and doing what he needed to do to build pressure, to build speed through these tricky conditions. Across this middle flat, goes into sort of a more clean, relaxed mode across the flat, still pushing hard onto this final steep pitch. Again, just, you can see the cut up the snow is here, and you can guarantee that's on every single one of all of these turns. and he has to. And what we were talking about earlier with the floodlights is you can see it all. And if you can see where the start of the rut is and the exact place you want to initiate a turn, just means that you can ride it out rather than dropping into it a little bit low in the line, but doesn't really chuck him sideways. He just puts on all the pressure that he can do to bring those skis round. Hip is a little bit back, but that's in his transition. But by the time he gets to start of the turn, that hip is up and forward. So he's gone from in the middle. If you take this as his fall line between the turn, between the run, because he's got a slight angle fall away here. During the actual end of the turn, the hip is low in this position. But by the time he then starts the next part up here where he is now, the hip has come up. He's on the front of his skis. If we could have a side shot, snapshots of the a side angle here, you'd see that the hip is now up and forward, and he's able to then bring the pressure right at the start of the turn. And then the ski, look at the ski reacts, hits the bump again. But still, even though this is a really awkward position, hips really far back, again, the start of the turn, hips up and forward. Little mistake there, dances his way through the verticale, and now this is just head down, ski smooth, across the flat. Make sure you don't make any silly mistakes into the finish. And that is Kristoffersen's most emotional victory, his words, as he crosses the line to take the second World Cup victory of this season.
Okay, that's all the analysis for now. Ed, where are we heading to next?
Next up is going to be Bormio for the men. They race Monday the 28th, Tuesday the 29th. It's downhill followed by Super G. The training runs start on the 26th, so not too many mince pies and Christmas pudding for those guys. The ladies are racing over in Semmering in Austria, and they race also on the 28th, 29th. It's GS on Monday and slalom on Tuesday, and we're going to see a load of belting races. Hope for some harder conditions. Hope for some solid. Bormio is solid no matter what.
Yeah.
So, because that's mostly in the dark.
And the great thing is that people will be able to hear you on Eurosport.
Yeah. So if you haven't had enough of me, otherwise you can always mute me because I do like to talk a lot. Todd, thank you very much.
No worries.
Until next time. Goodbye for now. Happy Christmas.